Hey, good morning and welcome to Nine's coverage of the flood emergency that is currently gripping New South Wales. I'm Charles Croucher.
And I'm Davina Smith. And as we go to air this morning, 500,000 people across Sydney are under evacuation orders, told to either leave their homes or get ready to flee.
There are some 76 locations where residents and businesses are on emergency alert, from Picton, southwest of Sydney, through to Camden, Richmond, Windsor, Pitt Town, and there's also places northwest of the city as well.
There's a huge volume of water that is moving down the Hawkesbury Nepean River system. But that's only half the problem as we go to air this morning, because the rain offshore moving towards Sydney now in the next few hours could bring another 150 millimetres, and we have seen falls of up to 200 millimetres overnight.
It's an awful lot of water still to come. We are standing by for an update for emergency services that is due any moment now.
In the meantime, let's go to pictures that are fresh into our newsroom. And amidst all of this chaos, some of the rescues, those pictures that you're seeing right now are from RFS, a rescue that happened in Rossmore overnight. And we have pictures fresh into the newsroom from Werrington. This story is really quite extraordinary. We'll put a time period for you over this. It was a young family that had called the SES overnight. There was water surrounding their property at Werrington. They were starting to get worried, and they had really little kids. This was this morning. The only way out was a Navy Seahawk helicopter that had to come to their rescue. Watch the bag that the air crewman is carrying right now. One of the kids pops out of that. They could not have been in safer hands after a really, really nervous night. And Charles, we were looking on the maps. There's no key river or creek estuary near where they were living. They live on Water Street, this family, but this is just a reflection of the water that is rising at the moment rapidly.
And that's the problem.
Low-lying areas.
The water is rising effectively from the ground. There are creeks that run through that area, but nothing to the size of the Hawkesbury, the Nepean, any of those major creeks or rivers that we have throughout Sydney. This is a much smaller creek. Effectively, the water has logged the ground, the ground right across, particularly those catchment basins in the southwest and northwest of our city are drenched, and so any rain that falls, and there is a lot of rain that is forecast to fall, will run into the catchments, will run into streets and rivers, and that's why there is so much concern for those river communities, but also for low-lying communities, and then also at the coast.
Let's talk about Warragamba Dam. There it is. It spilt 600 gigalitres overnight. Now, that was the worst-case scenario prediction from the government. And to put that in perspective, that is how much water Sydney uses in a year. It is more than how much water Sydney Harbour holds. Last year, when we saw the floods in 2021, Warragamba Dam spilt 400 gigalitres. So it's already topping that. The entire dam, it holds 2,000 gigalitres. So we're talking about a third of the capacity of Warragamba Dam spilling over at the moment, flowing down the Nepean River, down the Hawkesbury, and you put that on top of the rain that we're forecast to see to fall in Sydney over the next 2 hours, and the Bureau has said that the next 2 hours for Sydney really has been critical. We've seen falls up to 220 millimetres overnight. They're now predicting 40 to 80 millimetres to fall within the next 2 hours, possibly falls of up to 200 millimetres in the next 6 hours. And the problem is, as Charles mentioned, the ground is already soaked.
A lot of that rain is falling to the north of Sydney at the moment, in particular the Central Coast, the Hunter region, and even in Sydney's northwest.
This is Windsor.
This is the bridge at Windsor last night. That bridge is now underwater. Gabby Boyle has been standing by at that bridge. This is the same bridge that was rebuilt after it went underwater last year, the same bridge that cut off a community for nearly a week from supplies, and that water just keeps on rising. This is one of a number of bridges right around, particularly the west of Sydney, that is under threat or underwater, and they are the two problems. And just looking at the rain map, Newcastle copping a hammering now, the Central Coast as well as Lake Macquarie. There is another front that is coming through for Sydney, and it looks like that's the front that we've been hearing so much about that may hit Sydney in the next few hours, in particular the next 2 hours. We are standing by to hear more from the RFS about both the flood that's going on here and also the flooding that is still happening to our north. This is the southwest of Sydney, though, and already places underwater.
And the sun coming up this morning to really show the huge volume of water that's moving through communities like Picton and Camden. It's not just a case that roads are flooded and people's homes are being inundated. They're also being isolated, and that's the issue that the SES and emergency services are really worried about. Not all these roads are built to withstand a flood. So if you're cut off, there's every chance you could be cut off for a number of days. These pictures from the RFS from Rossmore early this morning, where they've undertaken a rescue. As you can see, they've had a swiftwater rescue team out getting an elderly couple out of an area where they were stuck overnight. So a lot of concern for southwest Sydney. We saw Chris O'Keefe there at Picton yesterday afternoon, where the Stone Quarry Creek was rising quite rapidly as we were on air from him for the space of about 40 minutes. It rose about half a metre. We'll go back to Picton today and we'll show you some of the pictures there, because the town was really worried that as the water rose there, the bridge would effectively funnel the water down the main street and cause some epic issues. They had a flood in 2016 there, where the water came to the tops of the roofs of the doors in the main street there. They'd sandbagged yesterday to about halfway up. So clearly they've done some of what precautions they can, but if worst case scenario unfolds, which is what the forecasters, SES, RFS, what's what the government are saying today, just because you got flooded last year in 2021, or you may have escaped what happened last year, doesn't mean you're safe this year. They are expecting what we're going to see in the next 24 hours to trump all of that, unfortunately.
Yeah, the pictures out of Picton are pretty good this morning. The water has gone down, but as you said, this isn't over by any stretch of the imagination, and we keep getting told that the next 2 hours could be some of the worst. We stand by to hear from the Bureau of Meteorology and the RFS. The other thing we'll keep an eye on, and we'll go back to at some stage throughout this bulletin, is the situation in our states north and the southeast of Queensland as well, because another storm front went through Brisbane this morning. Exactly what they didn't need. That cleanup is beginning, and in some cases they're still waiting for the water to recede. There's also been amazing sort of scenes out of Lismore, where that cleanup is entering day number two after surveying all the damage, all the wreckage, all the lives and livelihoods that have been lost there. And they are still sadly undergoing the task in our states north of going from door to door and checking in on places. So we expect to hear more on that situation as well. High tide at Ballina, it's just passed. That's a good sign for what's to come. For Ballina, a community who was underwater yesterday, but a community that seems to have avoided the worst of what has happened.
So, and so lucky.
What's been going on there?
And we will keep our eyes, Charles mentioned, on southeast Queensland. We saw that huge dumping of rain as a thunderstorm passed through Brisbane this morning at around 7, 8 o'clock this morning. The problem is, though, that the city is back on alert for another intense supercell to move through this afternoon. It's not just going to bring rain, it's going to bring hail with it, gusts of up to 90 k's an hour. They're talking about hailstones in excess of 2 centimetres. So that's a big problem. As Charles mentioned, we saw they had 2 days of sunshine, so they took the chance to get everything out on the street, everything that had been wrecked by the flood. They were hoping and waiting for it to be picked up in council cleanups. Well, now all of that stuff that's just sitting there is now just going to be washed away if those floodwaters rise back up again. But this is the problem, and these pictures that you're seeing here at Warragamba Dam in Sydney, this is what is going to cause all the issue. It's spilling 600 gigalitres. Now, the state government said that that was worst case scenario. And if that's what happens, in light of the fact that last year during the March 2021 floods, we saw 400 gigalitres of water spill, and we saw the flooding, we saw the devastation that it caused through Sydney's southwest. This is going to trump it. The other major concern is we've had reporters in around Windsor this morning, one of the areas that are affected from all this water that's coming from Warragamba Dam. The forecast rise at the river there is 14 metres tonight. So that is 2 metres higher than what we saw last year, where it peaked around 12.5 metres. This morning, as we were going to air, the crews that were on the ground there were telling us it was sitting just shy of 11 metres. So that's a concern. It's well on the way to 14 metres. And the reporters on the ground there were also telling us it wasn't just the fact that it was rising so quickly, it was the ferocity of the river and how it was moving so fast. Because of all that water coming down from Warragamba Dam, it was so much more intense than what they saw 12 months ago. And there are going to be big questions there. The Windsor Bridge, we know, is brand new. It opened in May 2020, $136 million. It was never promised to be flood-proof, but they certainly said that it was going to be less flood-prone. Well, in the space of 12 months, it's flooded twice. And it not just cuts off the town, it causes isolation problems. And we saw last year supplies trying to get food and water and fuel into those areas when they wanted to clean up and move on with their lives. It really stalled the process there of people getting back to some sort of normality. So that'll be a source of a lot of frustration to as they watch those waters rise again around Windsor.
Well, you know that there's no other way around around it, unless you can go up, you know, via Singleton and the Putty Road, which itself is prone to flooding. I mean, that's where the majority of the rain is hitting. We are standing by to hear from the Rural Fire Service. I can tell you right now, there is a laundry list of warnings out from the Bureau of Meteorology that includes hazardous surf warnings for all of New South Wales. Flood watch is currently in place for parts of the Hunter, the Central Coast, Greater Sydney, Illawarra, South Coast and Queanbeyan. And let's go live now to this press conference with the Rural Fire Service in Lismore.
Morning, everybody. Paul Baxter, the Commissioner for Fire and Rescue New South Wales. We've just come in from Sydney last night to try and touch base with some of our crews, our first responders here in Lismore at the moment, right next to our Lismore station, standing on solid ground, reasonably dry considering the water level was up at our balcony level here. I've obviously visited this station before and the limits of 2017 come to about this high. The floods this time of epic proportions, you know, almost biblical, that we've seen here. I wanted to catch up with our troops that have been on the ground. Unfortunately, they've been reasonably isolated in lots of the towns and cities around here and still are. But as the water recedes, we've been able to get in and see some of those, and we'll continue doing that today. They've been having to do this work on their own, which is understandable and is what first responders do. And I'm very proud of the work that they've been able to achieve, supporting their local communities. They've been working exceptionally, exceptionally hard. Some of our communities, like Korokai, our own firefighters there, have lost their own properties in these floods, but they've continued to carry on working, and I think that's just simply outstanding. The work across the multiple agencies, the State Emergency Service, my own fire and rescue crews, the Rural Fire Service, Resilience New South Wales, we've now got the ADF coming in. There's a big wave of support coming behind the first responders that we'll see arriving over the next couple of days to get in and methodically assist the citizens who are doing their own recovery now efforts, as we see. Around these streets, you'll see people are tipping out their homes. They're starting to clean out their homes. A little bit of blue sky, which is always encouraging as well, but we still don't know what the weather's doing. So a lot of our resources are coming north from the Sydney area, and they'll be up here for as long as required. But unfortunately, as you know, the weather is hitting us in the city. It's hitting us all the way down the coast and the south coast. So our resources are going to be pretty spread. So we're going to need other support, which we are bringing in interstate to help this whole recovery effort.
What numbers are we talking about in terms of
Yeah, so in the initial phases, the first responders do very quick, rapid assessments of the damage that's occurred and whether people need support and assistance. Obviously, the police are managing the tallying up of people that are unaccounted for, and some people just haven't been heard from because communications here are very difficult, and often the numbers of unaccounted for are just people that haven't been able to communicate. So tallying up and cross-checking those lists is a really important factor to be done. But a more methodical damage assessment process will be followed in the next days as we go house to house. We use a computer-based system to check off all those properties and see what's inside them and talk to the local residents as we go. But we are talking, you know, literally thousands of homes now that have been impacted and affected. As I said, you know, this is pretty epic. This is a big disaster. And it's over such a widespread area, it's going to be hard work. But, you know, you've seen the resolve of the local communities. They're just getting stuck in and they're helping themselves. And we're going to try and back them in with our firefighters, with our emergency service workers, with the ADF that's been brought in as well to help that effort.
Is really etched in your memory of that effort made by your work, your teammates?
Yeah, we called in last night to the Mullumbimby town. It's been devastated. The local community, the houses they've all been badly flooded. We visited our local crew and we spoke to them last night about how they assisted residents out, people that were elderly and needed extra support. But I guess one of the really difficult things that has been to manage was taking people into evacuation centres and then people putting their hands up and going, I've also got COVID. So it's just these extra dimensions that are just making things so complicated and difficult to manage. But those local people, the local emergency services crews, the community members are getting in behind their people and helping. So this is not easy, and the next weeks are not going to be easy either. But the support from New South Wales Government to get into this and support the communities in every way we possibly can is there. As I said, you know, our local firefighters have lost their homes. They've been completely inundated and flooded, and they're out on the emergency lines today helping their communities. Have a word to Damien.
First of all, I'd like to thank all the partner agencies within emergency services that have supported SES with the response here locally, both in Lismore and surrounds. It's been a phenomenal joint effort in terms of that response, fire and rescue, Royal Fire Service, Marine Rescue, Maritime, VRA, and also the ADF as well. So the ADF currently have personnel here at the moment. They're bolstering the support as well, and more are coming in. And we've got additional support from Fire and Rescue and RFS as we speak on the way into town as well, to as we shift from what has been a response to recovery. It is also about close coordination as well with that shift from response to recovery, because while we are still responding to requests for assistance, going through and doing thorough damage assessments as well to property, and then supporting the community and residents with actually clean out and the like as well. So be doing that as soon as possible, and supporting the community to do so with in conjunction with them under their support.
Needing rescuing or support from the
SEM? So we're going through, today is the priority is actually for those requests for assistance that have not been fully closed out. Many of those people would have already, no longer they would have resolved the issue that they had actually put forward at the time. But it's important that we will go through comprehensively and make sure that they're all closed out, while we're also then going through and assessing damage to homes and also the broader community, those thousands of homes that have been impacted.
And your crews are still looking for people who are kind of listed as missing. Are they still looking for, you know, people who there may be bodies in homes?
So we'll continue to undertake the searches as well of properties that need to be searched. We do need to brace for, based on the impact of this incident, that there could be further deaths. I certainly hope not, but they'll continue to go through and undertake that work. And I did want to certainly thank the SES volunteers. They are members of the community here, and the support from the community as well for the work they undertake. Just like Commissioner Baxter mentioned with some of his teams, they've been personally impacted, they've lost their homes. They continue to provide volunteer support through the community without worrying and caring about their own situation at present. So it's quite amazing. I'm very humbled by the work they perform and the support to their community that they live in. Thank you.